Welcome to this video on the top 10 werewolves of the Children of Gaia. The Children of Gaia, occasionally known simply as Gaians, or among their own as Peace Weavers, had the distinction of being the driving force in a coalition of Garu who brought about the end of the Impergium, a fact that some werewolves have never forgiven them for. Yet, the Gaians have held fast to their belief that ending the Impergium was for the best, and that unity between not only the Garu, but Garu and man, will ultimately result in the healing of Gaia and victory in the War of the Apocalypse. But without further ado, the top 10 werewolves of the Children of Gaia. Number 10, Lore Speaker Gron. Among the legends of the Children of Gaia, none stand quite so tall as Lore Speaker Gron. Gron lived during the time of the Impergium, when, according to Gaian lore, there was only one tribe, the Garu. The Galliards argue whether or not Lore Speaker Gron was an Arun or a Philodox. Personally, I favor Philodox. Part of the reason for this is that Gron was a figure of balance between worlds. As a Metis, Gron was born neither human nor wolf. As a Metis, Gron was also born with hermaphrodism and was neither completely male or female. And lastly, as a Philodox, Gron was committed to duality, balance, and honor. Lore Speaker Gron is believed to have been born somewhere in Anatolia. At some point, Gron traveled to Lipinski Vir along the Danube in what is today Serbia. Gron's interaction with the people of those prehistoric villages convinced Gron that the Impergium was a great evil, one that prevented humanity from producing a culture that could create things of great beauty while also living in harmony with Gaia. Gron then wandered the earth for decades, making alliances, answering challenges, and earning favors, enough simply for the right to speak at the Allmoot and object to the Impergium before the entire Garu nation. However, Gron's family paid the price for Gron's desire for peace. Assassin's claves meant for Gron instead struck at those the Lore Speaker cared for most. Finally, the Allmoot came where Gron and the pro-peace faction, which included the Warders of Men, the newly formed Stargazers, and the Silent Striders, united against the pro-Impergium faction. When the pro-Impergium faction challenged Gron to settle matters through gamecraft, Gron agreed, but chose a Stargazer as its surrogate. This cost Gron renown, but by the time the contest was over, the pro-peace faction prevailed, and the Impergium ceased. Much like Lore Speaker Gron's auspice, its death was also a topic of contention. Some have accused the Garu who supported the Impergium of murdering Gron for its success. Others claim that the Lore Speaker perished while in conflict with vampires over the control of the city of Katalhoyuk in Gron's native Anatolia. Whatever the truth of the matter, Gaians still look to Lore Speaker Gron for courage and a reminder that the path of Gaia's peace is neither easy nor safe. Number 9, Siduri, Sabitu. Before and after the Impergium's end, the Children of Gaia made connections with human shamans and healers throughout the prehistoric world, especially those that revered Gaia. The Gaian Siduri Sabitu's network of priestesses was extensive, and she used it to warn humans against the influence of worm-tainted creatures, particularly vampires. One group of vampires was growing especially powerful in the ancient kingdom of Sumeria. Other Garu called for the heads of any human king who allied with the vampires and went to war with the emergent human civilizations and their vampire overlords. But Siduri knew that such efforts were doomed to failure. Vampires of this time were far more powerful than those that would come after them, and they could create armies of progeny in a matter of nights. She counseled, instead, that the Garu influence the mortal kings towards Gaia, rather than spill their blood. But the other Garu rejected this, saying that they had no hope of challenging the vampires in subterfuge and manipulation. And besides, what gift did the Garu have that could exceed the promise of immortality, even if it was a worm-tainted gift? But Siduri proved the wisdom of her own way by showing the great King Gilgamesh the fullness of Gaia's bounty and all of the pleasures, novelties, and sensualities that life had to offer him. By the time she was done, Gilgamesh rejected undeath compared to life. He would not surrender the pleasures of living flesh for cold, unchanging immortality. Gilgamesh even went one step further and organized his people to drive the vampires from his city, at least for the duration of his reign. But there is some uncertainty with respect to this tale. The lore of Clan Toreador claims that a vampire Methuselah by the name of Gilgamesh was embraced by Inoa, the Gangrel Antediluvian. To further complicate matters, the Celestial Choir tradition of mages lays claim to Gilgamesh as one of the first singers, the ancient master mages from whom the choir traces its lineage. Number 8. Raymond, Love of the Goddess. Raymond was born Raymond Hawkins in 1770 in the village of Woolgrave, England. His mother was a Gaian and his father a kinfolk and schoolteacher. Raymond's parents were great doers of charity among England's poor and hungry, and Raymond often joined them in their work. The first change came while he was wandering through the countryside, alone, one of his few personal pleasures. After undergoing his rite of passage, Raymond studied, attended college on a scholarship, and was ordained a minister of the church by the age of 17. Secretly, he was also a member of the Forest Brethren, a group of ministers who combined Christianity with Gaian teachings, made up primarily of Garu and kinfolk. When the English government began the project of transporting prisoners from the mother country to the penal colony of New South Wales, Raymond volunteered to accompany the first fleet as a chaplain. He sailed on the ship with the prisoners, preaching Gaia's love to them. Aboard the other ship sailed more respectable Garu and kinfolk, including the Silverfang Earl Blaze of Uffington, who promptly declared himself leader of Australia's Garu before their feet were even dry. When the Garu discovered their long-lost brethren, the Bunyip, Earl Blaze pronounced that the Garu would not only proceed with colonization, but that they would also take the Bunyip's cairns. As the Bunyip's kinfolk were both Aborigines and Thylacines, the Silverfang Lord declared them to be demonstrably an inferior race, barely Garu at all, and that their places of power should be put to better use by their superiors. Raymond loudly protested the treatment of the convicts, the natives, and the Bunyip. By 1824, Earl Blaze eventually grew tired of the turbulent Gaian priest's calls for charity and compassion, and had him sent to Norfolk Island under the charge of Thomas Brisbane, a place intended to contain the worst descriptions of convicts and men sentenced to death for crimes committed in Australia. But Raymond, Love of the Goddess, as he was known in Australia, rejoiced at his exile and said, "Who needs me more than they? And they may listen." Raymond spent years working side by side with murderers, rapists, and thieves. Eventually, he was released from his service on the island and settled in the Hunter River Valley, where he acted as a respected elder for newly arrived Children of Gaia to Australia. By the time of his death, the Children of Gaia were well established on the continent, though, to their everlasting shame, they would not succeed in Raymond's mission of protecting the Aborigines or the Bunyip from the Garu. Number 7. Garret Faithful. Garret was born in a small town in Oregon to Children of Gaia kinfolk. He was the descendant of the 17th century Gaian hero, Will Everard, Philodox of St. George's Hill, a Gaian commune located in Surrey, England. Garret grew up wandering through the mountains and woods of the Pacific Northwest, as well as the cairn located on his parents' commune. When the first change came upon him, Garret pledged that the Children of Gaia would never suffer another loss as they had at St. George's Hill, when the commune was broken up by the king's soldiers. Garret began wandering from cairn to cairn with a band of followers as peacekeepers. The Knights of Gaia's Hand, as they came to be known, pledged to settle differences between the tribes without violence, but when battle was joined, they would fight against the aggressors and protect the innocent. When the war in the Amazon began, Garret and the Knights of Gaia's Hand joined the conflict, aided by the Chalice of Renewal, a mythical Gaian fetish that can heal almost any disease or wound. The knights gained in renown, and Garret's faith in Gaia produced veritable miracles, and not only in battle. Tales spread like wildfire through the Amazonian warg of Garret bidding trees to walk, persuading rivers to divert their flow, and warriors being healed of fatal wounds, and was thereafter known as Garret Faithful. Meanwhile, Garret became troubled by the success he and his knights were having. They would win battles, but he worried that by resorting to war as a first resort, that they would only feed the worm through violence. Garret debated, well away from the hearing of Gogol Fangs first, whether it was time to begin a different approach to the war in the Amazon. Number 6. Cernonous. Cernonous is a Metis Theurge who serves as the arm of the goddess in Australia's Ninbin Protectorate. He was born of a mating of two Garu, a Serbian mother and a Filipino father. Because the Children of Gaia are not as ruthless in their treatment of the Metis as other tribes, he was not raised with a sense of inadequacy and self-loathing common among those whose very existence violates the litany. So he was shocked and surprised when he first encountered prejudice from Garu outside of the tribe, who pointed out that his horns marked him as unnatural. Rather than accept his fate as tainted, Cernonous entered human society as Kerwin Nostrum to study the science of genetics and possibly free himself from the Metis taint in his body. Cernonous spent most of his time in human form, sinking deeper into both research and alcoholism as his studies failed to produce the results he desperately desired. One night, as he staggered along the Bondi beach, happily drunk and singing to the stars, he saw a figure dancing along a path of moonlight reflecting off of the waves. It was the goddess Gaia herself, he thought, and following at her bare heels was a small, hopping animal, a thylacine. Cernonous took it as a sign from Gaia that his purpose was not to repair himself, but to restore the Bunyip who had been destroyed by the Garu in the War of Tears. Cernonous devoted himself to finding any trace of thylacine genetic material and, if he was lucky, Bunyip DNA in the wilds of Tasmania, enough, he hoped, to clone a Bunyip and bring them back into the world. He did not share his project with anyone in his Scepter tribe. The only other Garu who knew of his research was Darius Winchester, the Silver Fang King of Australia, who was also the sponsor of his project. Quietly, Cernonos' research was also being watched by the Progenitors, a convention of the technocracy which focuses on biological sciences, medicine, pharmacology, and genetic engineering. While the Progenitors are perfectly capable of creating all manners of monstrosities on their own, cloning true Garu would give the technocracy a powerful advantage in both the Ascension War and the elimination of those they deem reality deviants everywhere. But after Cernonos' search in Tasmania proved fruitless, he gave up and returned home. But 2 days later, as if by providence, a special exhibit arrived at a museum near to him. Allegedly, the exhibit contained the preserved bones and skin of a thylacine, recently discovered on Tasmania. Unwilling to let this golden opportunity pass him, Cernonos broke into the museum and acquired some of the genetic material. When he returned to his lab, he used technology and spirit fetishes to extract DNA from the dead flesh and bones. The fact that there were abnormalities within the genetic material and the silence of the spirits in regard to actually giving him information about the Bunyip did not trouble Cernonos over much. In fact, he extracted enough DNA to produce 12 clones, 10 females and 2 males. When they were finally born, they were smaller than he had expected and smelled like Garu, yet something about their scent was not right. But regardless, Cernonos taught them the Garu tongue, English, and a smattering of Aborigine words. The clone Bunyip cubs underwent the first change a mere 2 months after they were born, and seemed to form a pack led by the largest of the females. But Cernonos found himself in a precarious position. While he wanted to present his triumph to the Jinda Bean Council and integrate the clone Bunyip into Australia's Garu society, some of their behavior disturbed him. They hunted well as a pack, yet they not only savored the hunt and the meat, but they also appeared to derive pleasure from the terror and the suffering of the animals that they would kill. How did Jeffrey Dahmer's career begin again? I seem to have forgotten. Anyway, as they grew larger, seemingly by the day, the cloned Bunyip became furtive and conspiratorial around Cernonos, always whispering too low to be heard when he came near them. But Cernonous has not yet noticed the growing madness behind the eyes of his creations, madness that might spell the doom of the Garu of Australia. Number 5. True Silverheels. True Silverheels is an Aurun Gaian who serves as the arm of the goddess in the sept of the Hand of Gaia, located in upstate New York. True Silverheels is equal parts warrior and libertine, and pursues both with seemingly relentless energy. In his capacity as arm of the goddess, it falls to him to enforce Gaian policy for the sept and the tribe throughout New York. As such, he is the most visible symbol of the Children of Gaia's strength in the state, which leads other tribes to assume, incorrectly, that he commands the Children of Gaia. Apart from his duties to sept and tribe, along with his own pleasures, True Silverheels is an ally to the Silverfang Loba Carcassonne, who runs the Heaven Pack, an underground railroad of sorts for children and teenagers victimized by the Seventh Generation, a cult of the Defiler Worm that operated in secret throughout New York, though the cult would not be exposed and destroyed until Jonas Albrecht assumed leadership of the Silverfangs. Number 4. Pearl River. The Children of Gaia, despite their efforts at diplomacy, are not well understood by the other tribes. One of these misunderstandings extends to how leadership works among the Gaians. According to Gaian tradition, their septs are ruled by at least 2 to 3 Gaians. The voice of the goddess, usually female, who sets policy for the Children of Gaia, in conjunction with the will of the goddess and the advice of the arm of the goddess, who is usually male, and implements policy and enforces the litany. In the Hand of Gaia sept, the Hamit Theurge, Pearl of the River, or Pearl River, serves as the voice of the goddess and co-leader of New York's Children of Gaia, along with True Silverheels, who more often than not acts as her advisor. Pearl River's goal is to unify the tribes of New York in the face of the coming War of the Apocalypse, but despairs as the Garu seem hell-bent on wasting their strength and their blood on useless infighting and settling of old grudges. Pearl finds herself forced into a position where she may have to cede power to True Silverheels and allow him to rule as the sole authority for the Children of Gaia, which would break millennia of tradition. Whether he ruled in fact or merely as the face of the tribe would be another matter entirely. Yet she wonders if such a move can be done without sowing the seeds of rancor and division, only for them to bloom at the worst possible moment. The fate of New York's Children of Gaia, and possibly of all its Garu, might rest on the knife's edge of her choice. Number 3. Sarah Rashida Ben-Fasil. Sarah Ben-Fasil is a Gaian Theurge born to Israeli and Egyptian kinfolk. She served in the Israeli Defense Force and received additional training in asymmetric warfare as well as counterinsurgency operations. Despite her skill at war, she has a talent for gifts that spread harmony and peace to those around her. Whether by design or by accident, Sarah discovered the resting place of an ancient vampire near Jerusalem, and perhaps one of the oldest. Sarah has managed to touch the outer reaches of the creature's madness-ravaged mind, which either causes or exacerbates the phenomenon known as Jerusalem Syndrome. Additionally, she has been able to glean a single name from the slumbering monster's tormented psyche, Malkav. Sarah plans to heal, or failing in that, destroy the ancient insane bloodsucker, if it is possible to even do so. Until that perilous day comes, Sarah works to come up with an antidote to the lunacy that the vampire spreads throughout the region, and her efforts have borne some fruit. In her lifetime, Middle Eastern leaders have made, and more importantly kept, treaties free from the vampire's artificially induced frenzies. Number 2. Cries Havoc. Thanks in no small part to the actions of Lore Speaker Gron, the Metis are not nearly as feared or despised among the Children of Gaia as among other tribes. Cries Havoc was born a Metis and raised exclusively in the bawn of his cairn. As such, he was steeped in the lore, philosophy, and rites of the unicorn, yet was almost completely ignorant of the outside world. He earned his name from his rite of passage and his subsequent tendency to speak in explicit and graphic detail about his visions of the apocalypse and the need for unity not only between septs, but between tribes as well. Cries Havoc believes that the time of the tribes is ended, and that the Garu must become one tribe, one pack, and one people once again, if they are to have any hope of victory against the forces of the Worm. To this end, Cries Havoc has worked as an ambassador and mediator between the Garu, their packs, septs, and tribes. But Cries Havoc's struggle is both monumental and perilous. The wounds between many of the tribes runs deeper than canyons. His difficulty is compounded by his metis deformity, a pair of ram's horns curving back from his forehead, no matter what form he takes. He cannot move freely among either humans or wolves, as he is marked as inhuman on sight. While Cries Havoc feels no guilt for having been born as he is, he has often had to bite back resentment at those Garu who ignore his words and instead treat him like a freak due to his appearance, especially the oh-so-pure Silverfangs, Shadow Lords, Red Talons, and Geta Fenris. A lesser Garu would have given up in the face of the rejection and scorn Cries Havoc has met in his wandering. He's not even sure anyone would notice or even care if he gave up and slunk back to his sept in defeat. But he never learned to give up, and Unicorn will not allow him to give up. All Garu share the same blood and the same spirit. Cries Havoc must make the Garu see that, because their time, in this world, is about to run out. Number 1. Kelly Stillwaters. The Children of Gaia have their luminaries, but they have few of what other Garu would consider heroes. The Gaians do not seek glory in battle, but they have their own heroes, one of whom was born in the middle of the 20th century by the name of Kelly Blackford in Pine City, Minnesota. As a child, Kelly had strange dreams. Dreams about a peaceful, still world when the sun was young and wolves, men, and deer all dwelt peacefully near still waters. When she told her family about it, they chuckled, except for her old Finnish grandfather, Paavo. Paavo had come to America from Viipuri, Finland to Minnesota long ago because it reminded him of his homeland. So after dinner, Kelly and Paavo took a walk outside. Paavo asked his granddaughter what his father had told her about their family, but Kelly wasn't sure what he meant. Then the old man puffed himself up just a little bit and said, "When you have questions, little Blue Jay, you come to me. Soon you will know." In 1962, Kelly told her grandfather that she had a wolf dream, where she ran through the snow-covered forests and left paw prints in her wake. The old man laughed and welcomed her to the Children of Gaia, her other family. The old Garu told her about her lineage, of Gaia, and of the Way of Peace. When the first change came on Kelly, she soon after succeeded in her rite of passage and joined her new pack. They gave her the name Kelly Stillwaters for the dreams of her childhood. 4 years later, the Children of Gaia grew in number as other Garu from the cities of Minneapolis and Chicago joined them. This angered the Red Talons, who hated humans and Hamid Garu alike and feared them growing in numbers. Kelly, now a young woman, traveled to Minneapolis to poke around in that city's records, where she discovered that Pentex, through a number of proxy companies, was researching biological weapons in the area. 3 years later, in 1969, her sept's arm of the goddess, Robert Moonfriend, died at the hands of Pentex agents while infiltrating one of their facilities. The sept's voice of the goddess, Catherine, stepped down from her role. Kelly took up the mantle in her place, while her friend and packmate, Paul Awakes Before the Sun, became the new arm of the goddess. Kelly knew that attacking Pentex head-on was suicide, so she traveled throughout Minnesota, making contacts and alliances with the Bone Gnars, the Fianna, the Glasswalkers, and the Wendigo, and presented them all with a plan. The Bone Gnars infiltrated Pentex as janitors, cooks, and night laborers. The Glasswalkers broke Pentex's electronic security. Kelly, supported by the Fianna and the Wendigo, led the coordinated attack on the bioweapons labs outside of St. Paul. The lab's Fomori guards were slain, the weapons destroyed, and any trace of their attack was erased by the Glasswalkers. The Children of Gaia and their allies won a great victory. 3 years later, in 1972, the Get of Fenris and the Red Talons grumbled against the Children of Gaia about how the North was growing too crowded and that they did not have the territory that was their due. The Gaians, the Fenrir, and the Talons held talks, but nothing was resolved. At the same time, Kelly went to college, waitressed part-time, and led the Gaian sept closer to Gaia's wisdom. Also, in that busy year, Kelly and Paul became closer than packmates, as they spent late nights drinking wine, cheap beer, and in the morning coffee, talking about philosophy and politics, watching on with the rest of the world as humans landed on the face of Luna, and laughing at old horror movies. In 1973, the Get of Fenris and the Red Talons battled for territory on the Upper Red Lake. Heinrich Strongjaw, Jarl of the Get, sent word for the Children of Gaia to mediate their dispute. Kelly was wary of Heinrich, as he was vain and untrustworthy. He had refused to join in the raid on Pentex years before unless he was named leader. On the other side, Redtail, Alpha of the Red Talons, was an old wolf from her grandfather Pavo's generation, who nursed a long life of bitterness and resentment against the other tribes. But Kelly and Paul agreed to mediate the dispute. In November, they arrived at an old Croatan cairn, claimed by the Get. 15 Red Talons arrived with Redtail at their head, sniffing warily at the Gaians before assuming Cernonous in Hamid form. Soon after, 20 Get warriors arrived to make way for their Jarl, Heinrich. Kelly rose and welcomed the Get and the Talons, but Heinrich stared at her for a long, terrible moment before he barked out a loud, evil laugh. Then, in silent unison, the Get and the Talons fell upon the Children of Gaia with claw and fang. Kelly yelled above the howls of battle and demanded to know why they were doing this. Did they truly intend to stain the memory of their ancestors and break the peace of Mother Gaia? The Garu stopped fighting and looked at her. But Heinrich's cruel laugh once again cut the silence. He growled that the Children of Gaia spoke of peace, and yet their numbers in the north increased, while the numbers of the Get and the Talons decreased. He then leapt to kill Kelly himself. But Kelly shifted into Cernonous form and met the Jarl in battle. The two rolled and bit and clawed on the ground as his claws tore through the fur and hide at her throat and stomach. Kelly then called on Mother Gaia to aid her, and her prayers were answered in the form of a halo of fire surrounding her, blinding and burning the Jarl. Kelly took Heinrich's life as she broke his neck with her fingers, which were wreathed in flames. When Heinrich's body fell limp to the ground, the Get of Fenris flew into a rage. The Red Talons quickly joined them and the battle was resumed. The Children fell back into the forest, pursued by the Get and the Talons. Paul was surrounded and wounded by 3 of the Red Talons before Kelly leapt to rescue him. She carried him off to the east until she was certain that they had escaped. She laid Paul on a pile of leaves. He was safe, but would need time to heal. And the others needed her. Kelly kissed Paul, knowing that it was the last time she would ever do so, and whispered, "Forgive them, and think of me." Then she was gone. Some of the Gaians had escaped, but others were surrounded on a hilltop by the Talons and the Get. As Kelly raced back, her stomach still bleeding from her battle with Heinrich, she was met by her grandfather Pavo, with a force of Gaians and Fianna at their backs. Led by Kelly, the Gaians and the Fianna hit the Talons and the Get from behind. Another Gaian, Robert Torchbringer, set fire to the old wood to distract their foes while the beleaguered Gaians on the hilltop scattered to safety. Kelly organized their escape, but as she prepared to flee herself, she heard a small, fearful whining in the woods. A litter of Red Talon pups were trapped beneath a burning log. When Kelly saw them, all of her rage and pain melted away from her, and she was filled with a sense of peace. She had a memory from childhood, and remembered that every living thing was sacred, infused with the dance of life. Her last act in this world would be one of love. Kelly tossed the log away from the pups and carried them in her arms back to where the Red Talon's war pack sat. The Get and the Talon saw her walking towards them, her fur smoldering from fire and matted with blood, much of it her own. She handed the pups to Red Tail, then fell to the ground, her life spent. For a long while, the Get and the Talon stared at her body, unwilling to touch her. When Paul recovered from his wounds, he did not seek vengeance against the Get or the Talons, answering the calls from the Fianna and even some of the Gaians by telling them that Kelly would not want that. Redtail, for his part, and for the rest of his life, held Kelly Stillwater's name as one of honor among the Red Talons. The Get slunk off to nurse their wounded pride, but did not attack the Children of Gaia again. Kelly Stillwater's legacy, her gift to the Garu, was peace in the North, paid for with her own brief life. And those were the top 10 werewolves of the Children of Gaia. The Children of Gaia are probably one of the more admirable tribes of Garu, even if they are idealistic to their own detriment. But they know that it is one thing to be a warrior for Gaia, a role that they do not reject, and another to be consumed by war, to wage war simply as an excuse to satisfy one's own bloodlust and anger. The Garu's own history has shown that such a state of mind is fertile soil for the worm to plant its malignant seeds in. So we've covered the Avenger Wolves, the Scavenger Wolves, and the Peacemaker Wolves. Next up are the Storyteller and Lorekeeper Wolves, the Fianna. Until next time,